politics of betrayal. The recent election, the 2014 midterms, should neither be forgotten nor dismissed. They should be studied and remembered, for there are lessons to be learned there. While it was doubtless a wipeout for Democratic candidates, snatching from them their last grasp of legislative power, it was also a lesson on how little millions of people care about politics. For percentage-wise, the 2014 midterms came in as the lowest voter turnout since the early 1940s, when Franklin Delano Roosevelt was president and during World War II. But what made 2014 distinctive was that many Democratic candidates were running away from President Barack Obama as if he had Ebola. Many of these legislators were so-called blue dog Democrats or political conservatives who tried to attract some conservative love by turning their backs on Obama. Didn't help. Most of them got crushed anyway. It might also be noted that Obama himself turned his back on his natural constituency, black folks, reasoning that black voters may be pissed, but there's really nowhere else to go. So millions of them sat this one out, a silent non-vote of mass disapproval with the state of black life in 2014 America. Democratic talking heads began trying to make last-minute appeals to black voters, but it seemed too little, too late. Similarly, black issues are not on the legislative agenda, for politicians run from that, just as they ran from Obama. Why? Because liberals fear white backlash. They want black votes, but afterwards, blacks are forgotten. Till next time. Why support a party that runs from you? Why support a party that doesn't support you? Questions from the 2014 election. From Imprisoned Nation, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal.
These commentaries are recorded by Noel Hanrahan of Prison Radio.
Oh yeah, black sun in the hills. Oh, but shizzle dizzle. We got an excellent show here today, but first I want to say the views and opinions and that of the Comcast does not reflect its staff, its associates, or interns. With that being said, and the views of Black Sun does not reflect that of the arena. We are a council. So doesn't necessarily mean whatever views and opinions I got don't necessarily mean the panel agrees with it, and so on. So with that being said, I want to introduce the lovely First Lady of the arena. How you doing, Mary?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing good. Freedom fighter. We gave you the title back.
For sure.
All right. To his, Ben, introduce yourself. You got such an extravagant style. I don't want to mess it up.
How y'all doing? It's your man, Vince Cheeks, actor, activist, extraordinaire. You know what time it is. Welcome to the arena.
And Yanga, you know, I always say, just happy to be here, happy to tackle some of these issues and address some of the hot topics going on. So I'm looking forward to this one today.
Excellent. Okay, and we got an announcement. You got to have the announcement.
Public service announcement.
Yeah. Before we get kickstarted into the show, I have an announcement once again for the 11 Alive Canathon, which will be happening December 5th at 5 a.m. at the Gold Lot of Turner Field. Please come out and join us. If you need more information, you can go to www.11alive.com/canathon.
One more time.
www.11alive.com/canathon. You can also call Patty Burnett of Be On Top Entertainment to make donations. Her number is 404-914-2931. Please come out and help us celebrate, help us make a difference in the lives of those in need. Be On Top Entertainment will be there. Fraternal Order of Eagles, if you don't know who they are, they're a very old humanitarian group here in Atlanta. They do a lot for the city of Atlanta and across the country and here in Canada. So Google them, Fraternal Order of Eagles. Publix and the Salvation Army will all be coming together December 5th, 5 a.m. Go Lot Turner Field. Please come out and help support. Thank you. Let's talk about Jerusalem.
Yeah, let's talk about it. I mean, didn't we just do a show and we were talking about ceasefire?
Yeah.
I could have sworn we were just talking about ceasefire. This wasn't too long ago, Vince.
No, it wasn't too long ago. A couple of months, maybe.
Couple months. We did at least get a couple of months.
Right, I think we got a couple of months. But Miriam, my question, so the ceasefire was still supposed to be in
effect? It's still in effect, even though Israel continues to violate the ceasefire. On that note, by the way, they killed a man in Gaza today.
That's right, they sure did.
They killed a man in Gaza today.
That's right. It was a farmer.
A farmer, right. And they said he was trying to gather one of his birds. Mm-hmm. And bring one of his birds back to the flock, and that caused him his death. Because you know those terrorists
crossing that borderline,
I mean,
it's a threat to Israeli children. Yeah. And
it's a cross into his own land. Right. Is a threat. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Well, you know, it's unholy to cross into your own land without permission from
exactly
our great Benjamin Netanyahu.
Well, yeah, there's been a series of violent events over the past couple of weeks. Like Miriam just said, apparently someone was killed in Gaza today. I didn't hear about that.
Yeah. That was only today, not to mention everything you're about to mention.
Right. On November the 16th, Yusuf al-Rahmani, age 32, father of two, he was apparently found dead on his bus.
Wait a minute. They said he committed suicide because he was a homosexual.
The Israeli police claimed that he committed suicide, but the victim's brother, Louis, he suggested that the marks on his body indicated that his brother was beaten before he was lynched or whatever was done to him.
Hey, you know,
reminds me of the Gary Webb movie. Remember when they said he shot himself in the back of the head
twice.
Yeah, all these suicides are just amazing.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. And so, because of Yusuf al-Rahmani's death, I'm sure you all may have heard that on November the 18th, there was an attack at a synagogue in Israel where five people were killed, three U.S. rabbis, one British rabbi, and one Israeli policeman were killed. The four rabbis, they have dual citizenship with Israel. And Benjamin Netanyahu was pretty upset about that. And he said that this cruel and dark murderous event will not go unpunished.
Did they say in the news that they had dual citizenship? Did they put that in the news?
Yes, they did. They definitely wanted to focus on how American and British they are.
Oh, yeah. Well,
you know, they're from the civilized part of the world. And anybody who would... who's actually watching the news and paying attention would say, you have Americans and you have a Brit over here in Jerusalem. These Palestinians have been in Jerusalem for centuries, and you're telling me they don't have the right to kill these people who have dual citizenship, who the second things get bad can just hop on over back to America.
But Miriam, according to Netanyahu in Israel, these people were just going to the synagogue to pray. They weren't bothering anyone. And then these quote-unquote vicious murderers came in and basically turned the synagogue into a bloodbath, from what I understand.
They called that.
It was two Palestinians carried out the attack wielding meat cleavers, an axe, and a gun.
Miriam, that sounds like an act of a terrorist there.
That sounds like acts of martyrs. Were they martyred?
They were killed in a shootout with the police, yes.
Okay. You know, you find it as one of the things we were talking about, that propaganda. And that's exactly what it is. It's like pulling somebody into your fight. They're going to make notice, let you know that they were American citizens.
Right.
And that's just to pull them into the fight. You know what I'm saying? Like, look, you know. And so you get that type of thing. One of the things that the Palestinians are going through is what we go through here as Africans in America is the dehumanization thing. You know, when they show pictures of the Palestinian people, they're going to show you, they try to show or portray them to be this barbaric, untamable, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
right.
Type of people. So they're going through the whole dehumanization process. So what are some of the solutions? Because we know the problem, the killing's going on.
Yeah.
So what is it in the long run, Mariam, what is it, again, and I think you've said it before on a couple shows, but I'd like for you to reiterate it. What is the long-term goal, and what is it that the Palestinian people are asking for?
To end the Zionist occupation of Palestine.
So you want all of them out of there?
You either leave or you denounce Zionism. And you agree to live as a citizen in Palestine.
denounce Zionism.
Wait a minute.
That's a tall order.
Most definitely. I mean, if you're going to advocate for Zionism, you're going to advocate for this cause that has killed millions upon millions of Palestinians, and you don't have the right to live in the land.
You know, it's funny, Miriam, because they have the same demands. They want the Palestinians to be citizens of their country.
The difference being that Palestinians aren't occupying Israelis. They're occupying our lands. We have been in our land for centuries, whereas the concept of being Israeli is this new concept, aside from the ancient Israelites of the Bible and the Quran and the Torah.
Man, yes. You're going to be the first woman I gavel.
I think she has to explain what Zionism is, too.
Right. Yeah, you're going to have to explain Zionism.
That's the whole thing. Yeah. When they say they want an end to Zionism, it's not an end to the Jewish religion.
Yeah.
Right.
It's an end to this political understanding of what Zionism is. It's the same thing as us saying that we want to end to the skinheads and the Ku Klux Klan, to white supremacy, basically.
So that's white people.
Yeah, but not white people. We just want to end to those racist white people who use, you know, Christendom or whatever to justify, justify terrorist attacks violence and atrocities against an African people here in America. So that's what Zionism is. A lot of time, misinformation
comes out. They use the Torah to justify Zionism?
I mean,
no, because if you were actually to follow the Torah, then Zionism is not justified.
That is true.
The founders of Zionism were atheists. Zionism is a racist, imperialist ideology that advocates for the establishment of a Jewish state in Palestine.
So Jewish nationalism.
Jewish nationalism. Jewish supremacy.
Extreme.
In which a Jewish life is more valuable than any other human being's life. One Jewish life is more valuable than the 1 million Palestinians who are forced to leave Palestine in 1948.
Is there actually written documents of this?
Yes, mm-hmm. Most definitely.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Actually, in the Balfour Declaration, in which Britain approved the creation of the Jewish state, which was before the Holocaust. A lot of people want to say Jews were being persecuted in Europe, the Holocaust. No, this was before. I want to say it was 1917, in which the Balfour Declaration came into place. And they said whether or not this is, I don't know the exact wording, but whether or not this is a good or a bad cause, whether or not it is unjust to expel about 1 million Palestinians from their lands, it doesn't matter.
But, okay, you're talking about Zionism and Jewish supremacy, but you have Palestinians that are in the Israeli army. How does that work? I'm confused.
I mean, just like there are traitors and every other place in the world.
Wow. Oh, man. Hold on. Okay, she went in on it, and she's actually correct because from what I was reading about the minority soldiers is what they call them, which is the Palestinian minority that serve in the Israeli military.
Okay.
And it was stated that that is one of the biggest Palestinian taboos that you can take part in.
Well, what do they offer them, Vince? Being called traitors and turncoats.
Well, like she said,
it is
tantamount to treason. A lot of people feel that way, but what they offer them is basically equal citizenship. They offer them equal citizenship for serving in the Israeli army, which causes a lot of conflict.
So we're talking like Palestinian version of Jay-Z's and Beyonce's
But it's very, let me include that, it's very rare that they're Palestinian Muslims or that they're Palestinian Christians. Usually they're Druze, which is another sect.
So and Palestinian atheists.
No, they're not atheists. Okay, their beliefs are not Islam. It's not Christianity. It's not Judaism. They have their own set of beliefs, and they're usually the ones that join the Israeli military.
Yeah, well, from what I researched, it stated that the Palestinians that are still in Israel, they just somehow happened to avoid being expelled during the occupation in 1948.
Yeah.
And so these are the descendants of those people who didn't get expelled during the occupation. And so a lot of
there are various different reasons why those people were able to stay in Palestine.
But give us one, Mary. Give us one.
I mean, I couldn't tell you all the reasons, but one of the reasons is that it looks good to have a minority Palestinian population, in which not all of the Palestinians are kicked out. Because now, I believe in, I don't know, it was one of the 2000s that Miss Israel was black. So they try to give this image to the world that, oh, we have Arabs, we have black people, we have... we have Jews from Europe, and right. it gives into this whole we're civilized and we're able to all live in peace and harmony, which right. we know is not the truth.
For the record, I just want to say this real quick for the record, because you know you got some black separatists and black supremacists out there saying, "What's that got to do with black people?" It's a little side note. Israeli has the largest female black prison population.
Wow. Okay.
And this is confirmed by Cynthia McKinney. Okay, go ahead. Okay. I just wanted a little side note there.
Yeah. I want to come back to that in a minute, but a lot of many rights and benefits in Israel are tied to military service. Some of these benefits,
just like America,
include a variety of jobs, entitlement to state-controlled land, and economic privileges such as cheap loans, government allowances, and tax breaks. And they said that the offer of land is a very powerful incentive for these young Palestinian minority men to join the...
What about political participation?
Yeah, they'll find out about all of it when they get pulled over and get your head bashed in. You know what I'm saying? I don't care. I mean, it's funny. So y'all need to start the Palestinian Panther Party. Y'all want me to come over there?
Yeah. It's called Hamas.
Okay. Well,
I'm glad you mentioned it. Right. Yeah.
And they'll find out that selling this, I mean, people can take a page from our history. I'm sitting here listening to all this, and it is our history.
It's the exact same story.
It is the exact same story. With different people. And what eventually they'll find out is, regardless of the promises, that's all they are, just promises.
Empty.
That this is ethnic cleansing. That this is racism on its highest form, that they are being racist and practicing bigotry towards the Palestinian people.
You sound like Dougie here.
Yeah, that's exactly
what
it is.
Don't make me gavel you.
Yay. That's I mean, what other reason is it?
Right. Well,
I mean, they're offering they're offering, you know, land, job opportunity, participation in government.
How do you
can I say something going off your point? On a cultural side note, as a Palestinian, you should know that Palestinians who are refugees and Palestinians who live in the West Bank and Gaza are skeptical of Palestinians who live in Israel, because on a cultural level, a lot of the time they find excuses for Israel. Right. They find excuses for the occupation. Ooh, they find exactly. They're I'm not saying all of them are Uncle Toms. A lot of them have done more than people living outside, and they try their best because they are inside to make a difference. Even now, they're rioting in Jerusalem, and a lot of the Jerusalem residents have Israeli citizenship, and they riot in Haifa and in Yaffa, and they try to do what they can, but a lot of them are traitors because they do give them these incentives to sell out their people.
Okay. Speaking of traitors and how they're looked at and ostracized, there was a Palestinian who served in the Israeli army. He went by S because he was he didn't want anybody to know who he was for obvious reasons. But he served in the Palestinian army for 2 years, patrolling the borders to prevent Palestinian infiltration. He said he believes it is reasonable for the state to connect citizenship rights to military service. After all, we are citizens of this country. But he did say that he felt conflicted when he served, being Palestinian and serving in the Israeli army. And he said most of the people there, roughly they've estimated 3,000 people that have served in the Israeli army. And he said most of them don't talk about it, and if they do, it's under anonymous conditions because there's so much shame.
Definitely a taboo, like you said.
Right,
yeah.
So he said because of the shame that's associated with, a lot of them won't even talk about it. Now, he did state that when he served his 2 years, he said he tried to be extremely nice to, you know, the Palestinian people. Wasn't that harsh.
I'm only
going to
hit you one time.
Yeah.
I'm going to hit you twice like the Israelis would do.
He shared his sweets and his food with the children, you know, and so he tried to make it, I guess, as
humane.
He was a nice Nazi.
Right. But like you said, a lot of them that did serve, they do try to come up with these justifications.
Yeah, exactly.
As to why they did it, I guess to make it seem less treasonous.
To justify, their betrayal of their people.
Right,
because
a lot of them were put on the front lines of the war. And not only were they put on the front lines of the combat, but they were sent into some of the most dangerous areas and given some of the most dangerous jobs, like finding the mines, of course, you know.
I mean, because at the end of the day, they're not Jews. You know what I mean? Right. So they're not going to be given.
I mean, that's just like with the army here when we first got integrated, and they had Operation Dark Shield to put all the black people on the front line.
Exactly.
And let the Negroes take all the bullets, you know, and let the white boys come through and clean
exactly.
it up.
Exactly.
First, now, you know, first they didn't want us to do that.
Mess is
at
that?
First, they didn't want us to do that. We were like up in, what was that place in Chicago where they made bombs and exploded like two or three times? They had us like loading ammunition.
Yeah.
Right. You know what I'm saying? We were like the bomb makers. Right. And they didn't want to do this. And like you said, then the white boys were coming back like, why we keep getting killed? And you know, the niggas like, and they put us on it. But see, that's what we've been waiting on, kill some white boys. He's like, shit, you send us to Germany and knock some white boys off? So we became the baddest fighters that you had out there. And it's a shame. And we go back to like what you say. So what about the incentives? So what about the incentives? It's like Brother Malcolm said. He says, don't take the knife out an inch.
Right.
And then say, look, I'm doing you a favor.
Right. I'm still hurting. I'm still bleeding.
Right. Right. How are you going to give me, as a Palestinian, if I was a Palestinian, how are you going to give me the right citizenship in my own land?
Exactly.
How are you going to give me, and like you and I were talking about discussing.
They're offering protection here.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, that's the thing. You know, didn't their forefather of this country say, give me liberty or give me death?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But see, now you allow you and I, someone like you and I, to say it, or many of them say it, they say that's a terrorist statement.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right, yeah.
That they preferred death than being oppressed and exploited by Britain or England.
Yeah.
Right.
Whoever their leaders was. So you have a people, it is only natural for people to fight for their land and to fight for it. And I'm glad we do shows like this, despite what our critics say or whatever, because they have to understand that revolution is not just a national issue, but an international issue, and that a lot of us internationally are fighting the same beast.
The same imperialist beast.
Okay,
and the same tactics are being used. Claim to be a humanitarian and care for all people, but then only want to help your people. Of course, you want to start at home and then expand from there.
Well, that's the only
but
way
if you're a humanitarian, you care about all people in general.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like people act like their love for other people is limited.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Like your care for other people, I can only care about black people. I can only care about Palestinians. How can you see people dying and not sympathize?
And not care,
you know, that's the issue.
We fight with them every day.
It happens within every struggle.
Well,
and
they aren't worth fighting with. I mean, they need to be watching this show trying to expand their mind and expand their horizons and understand that we aren't the only ones fighting a good fight in this world. It's going all over around the whole world.
Yeah. They were continuous, ready to have the same fights with the Hebrew Israelites, with the Muslims and the Moors, and then the Hebrew Israelites, the Muslims and the Moors, and then the Hebrewites, the Muslims and the Moors, and then the Hebrew Israelites, the Muslims. You know who I'm talking about. So, let me get a timeline here, Vince. This offer of joining the armies and citizenship, and you can jump in, Miriam, was this also during Yasser Arafat's time?
I need to ask Miriam.
I mean, it's been since the beginning of the occupation that the Palestinian residents who are in Israel, the settler colony of Israel, have citizenship.
Okay, so
when was the second, what is it called, Intifada?
The second Intifada was the late '80s.
Late '80s
into early '90s.
That was the first time that it really came to light that there were. Palestinian minority fighting in the Israeli army, because the guy I was just talking to you about, he served in that second.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's not even worth it to talk about this small Palestinian minority who works within the Israeli military and betray their own people, because those Palestinian boys who are coming from the refugee camps in the West Bank and Gaza are so incredibly brave that it overshadows any treason. You know what I mean? When you have two boys who are willing to lay their lives on the line, go in with meat cleavers
to kill
people.
Right.
I mean, that is bravery. You're going in there saying, I'm going to die.
Right.
And it is worth
but
it.
But I'm taking some of y'all.
Exactly. And, you know, there are videos coming out in which Palestinian boys, little protesters, they have no weapons. So what they started getting fireworks. And what they would do is throw these fireworks at these Israeli soldiers. And these Israeli soldiers are running away, who are fully armed with machine guns, are running away from little Palestinian boys. And it seems funny while you're watching it, but it's not funny. Because that little boy could die like this.
Mm-hmm.
But he still puts his life online right. every single day.
No, I'm not laughing at the.
No, no,
danger,
I mean,
right.
we laugh at
I'm
it. We watch
at the
it.
Israelis
the,
running.
The Israelis
because...
running away from little boys with fireworks.
Let me ask you right. this question. So, for those few that have served in the Israeli army.
Yes.
Is it possible for that once they're done with that or whatever, and say they want to come back to where they know they yeah. should be and belong, are they accepted or are they just permanently shunned?
I mean, honestly, ostracized? I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know what happens with Palestinians who live in the settler colony of Israel. Because okay. what it is you have the occupation of Gaza and the West Bank. That is fully Palestinian, except in the West Bank you have Jewish settlers who are right. building okay. on right. what is internationally recognized as Palestinian lands. And then you have the State of Israel, which we know is Palestinian lands.
Wait. You say internationally recognized.
Yes.
What? I know Sweden
I mean,
recognizes, but like. As far
I mean,
as
so when they had the vote of having a Palestinian state and mm-hmm. having Palestinian state, most countries voted in favor of it. What it compromised was Gaza and the West Bank, not the settler colony of Israel,
oh,
not
okay.
Jerusalem. We know as a people, we know in our cause that Palestine is ours, but unfortunately, we live in a world of cowards, and they won't recognize that they...
In
yeah,
a world of corporations,
exactly.
too.
So they won't recognize that that's our land, but I'm saying what is internationally recognized is Gaza and the West Bank. So you do have those Palestinians in 1948 who weren't kicked out of Palestine, and those are the ones who are joining the military.
Okay.
So it's not the...
Not the ones
in
the West Bank and
Gaza.
Those they have a problem with collaborators. What they'll do is they'll go to these boys who they know their neighbor is a general in Hamas, and they'll tell them, okay, if you get this information on him, you know, we'll give you these benefits. If you don't get the information, then we're going to kill your family.
Okay.
Okay, so that's the difference.
Okay, so, Mary, I'm gonna ask you a question. During Yasser Arafat's time, and apparently this is before, I guess Yasser Arafat came into power, that they were having people, Palestinians, joining the army. So my question to you, and I question my same people with this kind of question, when you say traitors, mm-hmm. what specifically are you talking about? Like if you have, because you, I mean, you have even the world of Islam where
yeah.
you told, I mean, I remember you came on here and said, you know, ISIS is not practicing, you know, true Islam.
Oh, by the way, I would like to talk about
yes,
that.
Yes,
if I
please.
Can.
Okay.
Okay,
we can talk
I
about
wanted
it.
To say that we don't know what ISIS is doing, whether or not they are practicing true Islam. Because
well,
if the media
al-Baghdadi, who is a known atheist, says he's practicing true Islam.
He's a known atheist?
The Ba'ath Party are known atheists.
It's, I mean...
Saddam, well, I, you know,
I mean,
some of them were. Now, I'm going to say all
I mean,
of them.
I mean, yeah.
But they were like, you know, they're capitalists, basically.
Yeah.
You know, they were westernized. When
yeah,
I say
they were very secular.
Yeah, let's just say
secular.
I don't want to call them atheists, but they were very secular. That so al-Baghdadi was one of them. You know,
yeah.
he was very secular. You know, very westernized, smoking cigars.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
prostitutes, the whole nine yards. So I'm just saying, you know,
just make, it might just make him a bad Muslim.
Yeah, exactly.
Kicking out the fold, you know.
Oh, yeah,
you know he might just, you know, got some tall to do. Maybe got to make some repentance.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, okay. But I'll ask you this too, Yang. You know, you're Muslim. My question is that what is the? In fact, I'm gonna ask this question for you too, Yanga,
okay.
and our community too. This is gonna be a double question for it. It's gonna be for the niggers and the Palestinians.
Okay.
What is the? And this goes for you too, Gideon. What is the barometer of betrayal? Like, what defines that traitorism? Like, what is? Because I mean, if you're looking at a
in Islam. You talking about?
I mean, just in general, like, yeah, because when you say culture, everybody's not Islamist.
Yeah.
I mean, are all the Palestinians Islamists?
No, of course not. They're Christian Palestinians.
Okay, so it's not necessarily the culture of Islam. It might be just nationalism, right?
It's both. I mean, when you support Israel as a Muslim Palestinian, even as a Christian Palestinian, you're betraying what the Quran has told you. You're betraying that.
Wait a minute.
It's the Holy Lands.
Wait a minute. So you're assuming that these Palestinians are Muslim?
No, I mean, they could be anything. They could be Muslim, they could be Christian, they could be Druze.
Druze, what are Druze?
Okay, it's considered an offshoot of Islam. It's you have Islam and you have Sunni Shiite, and it's considered an offshoot of.
So let me get this straight, and this goes for our community too. So you're assuming that these Palestinians are Muslims, therefore they are traitors.
They could be traitors as Muslims, or they could be traitors to their country. They could be traitors to their people, their religion, their country, the cause. There are multiple factors that make them traitors.
Okay, so they could have joined during the time where Israel, like Arafat, recognized Israel.
Mm-hmm. So that would still be wrong. Just because our leaders betray us doesn't mean that we should betray our own cause.
I'm confused here.
I mean, our cause isn't based off of the words or the actions of our leaders. Our cause is based off of our cause.
Okay,
it's based off of what it is to end the Zionist occupation of Palestine. You could have every single Palestinian leader recognize Israel. It doesn't mean the people will.
Okay, now, because I'm talking before, pre-Hamas here.
Okay.
You had people
PLO,
join.
You're talking PLO.
Yes.
PLO, yeah.
PLO, right.
And PLO was strong. I mean, yeah. what it is now is not what it used to represent.
Right, but PLO compromised, and they recognized Israel.
Yes.
Okay,
they became weaker than what they were before.
Okay, so what faction went against that and said, no, you guys, no, we're not going along with that. So
okay, so you have, it's Jabha, which is the Palestinian Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine. They're the communists.
Okay,
so you have the communists that were not with that. You have Hamas. You have these organizations that left the PLO because of their betrayal. And then you have organizations that...
Miriam, you're confusing me.
I mean, you're asking very complicated questions. You're asking
who left. Let me tell you why it's complicated. Okay. Let me tell you why it's complicated. Because you have all these different factions, okay? This not only applies to Palestine, this applies to the black community, this applies to Hispanics, this applies worldwide. Mm-hmm. Let me show a simple lesson to the world here.
Break it down, black.
You got all these different factions of Palestinian people that have alignments with different groups,
Yes. Okay?
And I respect the diversity of the Palestinian people. Because I know for a fact that all Palestinians, all Arabs are not Muslims. I know
this. Of course,
this. Right. Okay, so.
There are Christian Palestinians who are just as dedicated to the cause.
And it may not even be no Christians there, is what I'm saying. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
They might not just tell you, but they'll tell a person like me.
You're saying they might be atheists.
They might be an atheist.
They might be.
So what I'm saying is that, so how do we hold them accountable to something they don't have an allegiance to? Like, somebody can say, well, black son, you're not a black supremacist. You're not a black separatist. No, I'm not. I never said I was.
Right.
It doesn't matter. Your skin color says you are.
No.
If you have the black skin color and you say something against your own people, you're a traitor. It doesn't matter what you identify with.
No. It doesn't. No. Well, if I say something against the bourgeoisie, that's something against my people, right?
Of course.
Okay, so... I'm confused here.
I think it goes back to ideology.
Right.
It goes back to ideology. Like, as a black nationalist, black nationalism is...
Which is not a black separatist or black supremacist.
It's not a black separatist,
right.
Nor a black supremacist.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, even though I advocate the separation of the black man from a lot of things over here, but that's a whole nother thing.
We say that for the king of the black separatist show.
Right. You know, I will be on a black separatist show, not a black supremacist, but a black separatist. But when you're talking about black nationalism, the empowerment, the liberation of African people here, the right to have to live our life without the willful hindrance or encumbrance of any people based on our ethnicity, our skin complexion, our origin, our heritage. Black nationalism is comprised of what? Muslim, Christians.
That's right. Atheists, Hebrew Israelites,
you know what I'm saying, like my dear brother Gideon. But if you're saying someone is going against the cause of black nationalism, going against the cause of empowering us, like, we're black nationalists, so we're not black integrationists. We don't believe
right,
in...
but one can say, and I'm about to stir some stuff up.
That's the difference. I get what you're saying. Someone who is in Hamas and someone who is with Fatah, the PLO,
right,
or the Palestinian Authority, they don't hate each other. You're not a traitor,
right,
because you're with one group or another. You're
right.
A traitor if you're against
it's
the cause as a whole.
Cause.
Your technique of ending the occupation is not what makes you
right.
a traitor.
Right.
What makes you a traitor is saying that the occupation doesn't exist. It's saying that the occupation is justified.
Okay, but hold on, Mary. I don't think Yasser Arafat denied the oppression and occupation. Did he or did he not?
He did not.
Okay, he did not. So what I'm saying is that him and the PLO had a different method.
Yes.
I want to just say, like Yang say, taking the boot off the neck. So what I'm saying is that I don't.
You're saying we don't know what Yasser Arafat's.
What I'm saying is I don't tell. What I'm saying. Oh man, this is complicated, man. This is really.
Don't call Yasser Arafat a traitor because he has.
Everybody has a different way of fighting.
Yes. And you know, I do think it is most Palestinians, I would say, would get upset to call Yasser Arafat a traitor.
Right, I don't.
Yeah, because he's tough with his little keep fighting. Yeah. Yasser is a bad boy.
Yeah,
you
know? I mean, because he gave his life to the cause.
Right.
And if he had a downfall, if he betrayed us, that does not mean that he was a bad leader.
Right.
It doesn't mean he was a traitor. It means that that was an act of treason, but he is not a traitor. See? Right. Okay. It's complicated.
Yeah, I get it. You don't get it.
No, it's
not
it.
You don't get
it.
No, it's the cause. It's the greater good. We're not telling anyone how to fight, but if you have the cause,
but that might be his way of fighting, though.
Not if it goes against the cause. It's like we say, nationalists are fighting for our empowerment, this and that. Then you got the reformists and the integrationists who say, hey, forget all that black stuff. Let's just be a part of America. Let's just blend in. Let's just do. That's betraying the cause of a people having self determination. That's betraying our cause of being recognized.
I got you now.
So that's what he's saying.
I got you now. So that's why I always ask for an agenda.
Yeah.
So if our people are going to be called a traitor for anything, a traitor to what?
A traitor.
Because most of these goddamn black people are theocratic.
Right, exactly.
They have brought, no offense, Islam with them, Christianity with them, Hebrew Israelitism with them, and I ain't for none of that.
But it's a traitor to our cause of empowerment. When you look to, if you get in Palestine, if you get someone who accepts these conditions or starts to work with the Palestinians, first of all, the thing of the cause of the Palestinian people, and we have Mariam here, can correct me if I'm wrong, is that, and my belief as a Muslim, that Israel is an illegal nation, is an illegal state. It is illegal. So any compromise or any working with them is to acknowledge a legitimacy.
Right.
And you can't, if it's illegal, it's damn illegal.
It's illegal.
You know what I'm saying? It's not legitimate. Illegal. So if you're going to start working with it, you can give me my rights and this and that. I can't come back in the later and say, but y'all really don't exist, but thank you for the Big Mac.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You can't give me, if you're illegal, you're illegal. And I think that that's the end thing. And it's like that with nationalism. If we say we want empowerment, we want the right to self-determination, but, okay, you know, I'll keep taking your food stamps, I keep taking your government support, and I don't want any end to it, I don't want any programs to help us get empowered. It's just we'll work with the government, but you guys know you're wrong and we really don't accept this. I mean, it's an oxymoron. What are you doing? I mean, either you're with us or you're against us, despite how hard the fight becomes.
Okay, but go ahead, Vince, because I'm still looking for an end goal here. An end game.
If you go ahead.
No, go ahead, please. All right. Please, because it probably will help me what you say.
I have a question for Mariam. This is about current leadership. You were talking about Arafat a minute ago. In regards to the synagogue attacks, this is from Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas. He condemned the attack, the first time he has done so since a recent spike in deadly violence against Israelis began. He called for an end to Israeli provocations surrounding the sacred site known to the Jews as the Temple Mount and to the Muslims as the Noble Sanctuary. Abbas also said it was wrong for either side to kill civilians. Hold on. Now that was President Mahmoud Abbas. Now, a spokesman for Hamas, Sami Zuri, he wrote on Facebook that the incident in Jerusalem was a reaction to Israeli crimes.
Right.
Hamas be on Facebook.
I see on Facebook.
Yeah, they be
all
over
on Facebook.
They on Twitter too.
All over, bro. Late to the game.
Oh,
but
everybody don't function like them Hebrew Israelites.
You're right. They are in the new millennium. And so Hamas said the reaction was to Israeli crimes and called for further attacks and bloodshed. So to me, it seems that there's a rift between what President Abbas is saying and what Hamas is saying. With that being said, which side does the Palestinian people lean more
towards?
Most
definitely Hamas.
Most
side.
Definitely.
Are you saying that because you're being biased?
No, most definitely. Okay, I'm going to say that Hamas has suffered a lot of bad PR in the past.
Right.
But when Palestinians see that Hamas stands up for the people, that when, especially like in the Gaza, the attacks
I'm
on
sure
Gaza,
they do, right.
Palestinians stand with Hamas,
so,
most definitely.
So is President Abbas, is he...
Oh, he's a traitor.
Oh, wow.
What makes him a traitor?
He said that's what I'm about to do.
No,
I'm about to about to ask whether he's soft.
I was just about to ask whether he's
soft. No, 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 I'm sorry. I'm sorry. He's scum. Yeah, like, he is horrible.
Okay, please explain. Please.
I mean, every time he stands up for Israelis, he collaborates with Israelis. He actually... So what it is the prison system of the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank, it's on the same computers as Israel's.
Okay.
So let's say they log in a new prisoner, a Palestinian prisoner, and they'll do the dirty work for Israel. They'll get information on a guy who's working to have an attack in Israel, okay, to attack Israelis. The Palestinian Authority will take it upon themselves to put him in prison, okay. And then eventually... Israel will see that this man is in the system, and they'll transport him to an Israeli prison.
Which I'm sure the
Palestinian Authority collaborates with Israel.
He's probably tired of y'all getting bombed. You know what I'm saying? I mean,
No. He's a millionaire, and his sons are millionaires. Okay. They benefit personally from their acts of treason.
Sure, they're getting some spoils of the war here.
Is that right?
So they're sitting down, these Palestinians, saying, you know what? You can get peace of pie too here.
Yes, okay, it's different. Okay, so Yasser Arafat, he stood with the cause. He fought for Palestine, and then it seems as though he grew tired. He wanted peace for his people. He still, even when he backed down as a leader. Whereas Mahmoud Abbas has never done anything for the people. He came in as a traitor and has remained a traitor.
How did he become president? People elect the president?
Yes.
First of all,
people elect the president.
It sounds like he started off. He was born a capitalist. So that's why I asked the question, traitor to what? We got to understand, whether you be Palestinian, black, that we have human beings that are innate capitalists.
Okay.
And so they look at our people being financially blessed as being free. So how do we define freedom? Because let's just say, the Palestinian
people... This is
a
philosophy class. I don't even know the answers.
They're using this, though. Because I see the same pattern in South America, in the black community, Palestine, all over the world, where they're using capitalism, and it seems like to be working very well. So what I'm saying, because... all around the world, you look at this economical squeeze, okay? Because we don't want to see starving Palestinian babies. We don't want to see black starving babies. You know what I'm saying? So they squeeze and then come with the, I got some money here. Yeah. Like Thrasher.
Yeah.
Well, your kids are starving there, Yanga.
Yeah, I got something for you.
Well, we got three mansions for you. How about that? We got a Maybach.
Say something really quickly? I feel that Yasser Arafat backed down for his people. When Mahmoud Abbas backs down time after time after time, the Palestinian people aren't benefiting. That's what makes him cut and dry a traitor.
Here's my question, and it goes along to what Vince L. Cheeks,
activist, TVO,
all-around personality, my man. What he said, if Mahmoud Abbas was democratically elected,
right,
and if the people elected him, that's the first thing. Secondly, then wouldn't it just be a tactic that he's using? It's like if repression is coming down. If I understand my man's that, you know what I'm saying? Like, one thing I love about the Palestinian people, y'all will put a twist, and that's Islam will give you that bravery. I'm telling you, Islam will give y'all will put a twist. It was like, it's brave for them to go into with meat cleavers and one gun against machine gun. You know, a lot of brothers be like, I ain't going, that's hell.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And it's not, I admire the Muslim religion. See?
Yeah, because
the Hebrews are like, and Christians are cowards.
Because in the long run, like you said, man, it's, you know, feast be life for the way of God, you know what I'm saying, seeking Jannah, seeking heaven, and the whole nine. But is it a case of, with the brother, with the president being democratically elected by the people, him being tired of the repression, and a few, and this is, please, don't take offense, Maddie, and my people out there, a few fanatics, which they would call them, a few fanatics, you know what I'm saying, look, well, we're going to go to war, and we're going to put the people in a fight. If the people have elected Mahmoud Abbas, and he's saying, okay, look, I'm going to work with Israel, not that I'm advocating this, but just for a frame of thought,
we're going to
work with Israel to get these more radical element out of here so that we can have some stabilization, so that we can start having some peace, because we got a few, you know, couple hundred or how many of people going starting, but the masses of the people suffer from the right. actions of a few who hold
on. Okay, well, let me address being democratically elected. The first time he was democratically elected, I want to say in 2007, I believe is the year, 2006. I want to say 2007, there was another election.
Another election. They stole it from Hamas.
Doesn't matter.
They stole it.
Where he was.
They stole
Hamas that
one from Hamas.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, they won the election.
So he stayed exactly where he was.
Yeah.
So we can't say he was democratically elected because he came off of, you know, the whole Yasser Arafat and Fatah and supporting the Palestinian Authority, because they supported Yasser Arafat. And if this man was his prodigy, if he was the next Yasser Arafat, they voted for him. Then they saw his policies. They wanted him out. But he stayed exactly where he was, which is Arab dictator.
So
you know, we know the story.
So you're basically saying he's not representative of the people.
Most definitely.
Right.
Technically, metaphorically, whatever you want to say, no way he represents the people. I mean,
so okay, so basically they had they voted him out. Okay, so it's starting to the smoke is starting to clear.
Mm-hmm. So does Hamas work with the president of Abbas at all, or do they?
No,
do their
actually something that they do. The Palestinian Authority and Mahmoud Abbas collaborate with Israel against Hamas. So, like you said, these more radical elements.
Okay.
Let's say, like I said, they're planning an attack on Israel. They will tell Israel what's about to happen. So they would rather sell out the cause than to make peace with Hamas. And what matters more to them is not the ends of occupation, the end of Hamas. That is their number one.
Wait! Now I got to jump in. Hamas says the same thing about Israel. They want to do away with Israel. No more Israel. So they're both saying the same thing. So if my enemy says
the Palestinian Authority isn't saying that. Is that what you're saying?
No, what I'm saying.
You're saying Hamas and Israel are saying that's their end goal.
Right. And so what I'm saying is that maybe there are some Palestinians that look at Hamas as being very radical.
Yes, of course.
Okay, that's number one. Number two, and we got proof because Gideon's our proof. It sounds like, let me just ask you a question. When this president, before Hamas was voted in, did you have Palestinians talk about, the system, the voting system doesn't work, and another group saying, well, we're going to try this voting system? Was that the reality?
When he was elected in the first time?
Yeah.
I have no idea what was being said. No, I really don't. I mean, I was a child.
But apparently some Palestinian people voted him in.
Yes.
They were going for the system.
Yeah.
Okay. And so what I'm saying is that there seems to be, you know, I've been working for the CIA a long time, and it seems like there's a rift here. There's a rift in every society. I don't really work for the CIA, but I'm But what I'm saying is that, you know, America, for a long time, this government has been an expert at exploiting the differences.
Yes.
Okay, and so what I'm saying is I know for a fact that there are rifts in the Palestinian people. And so that's why I say, what is traitorism and what is a sellout? Because they could go into that particular and learn the different factions better than the Palestinians.
Of course.
Okay. Because they go amongst the blast nationalists, learn about our culture better than we can.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, some of the top Klansmen know about Khalid Mohammed. They can name it down. All the black nationalists, you go in the black community, they're like, who is that?
Study enemy.
So
right.
What I'm saying is that you have a people that will exploit the slightest difference. And so maybe those people were never traitors to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So what I'm saying is that during Yasser Arafat's time, he was working with Israel, so apparently he recognized Israel. And those soldiers went in. They probably had a backdoor deal saying, look, you know, I'm willing to, let's work out a deal. Let's make a deal. You know what I'm saying? And part of that deal involved, you know, we'll allow some Palestinians to become soldiers. And we'll give them the house. We'll give them the 3-car garage. We'll give them the dog and the picket fence. Does that sound good to you, Yasser? It's better than us bombing. You know what I'm saying? So you're talking about improving a people's condition. And so,
that's sell out to the cause.
I'm like improving a people's conditions under what conditions?
My thing is whether regardless if it's right or wrong. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying it's not. I'm not making that judgment call right now if it's right or wrong. You know what I'm saying? I'm not in that position, this and that. But it's selling out for. If you start out saying, inexplicitly, you know what I'm saying, uncompromising, no compromising, this and that. We want an end to Zionism, and we want our land back.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And then 30, 40 years later, after getting them, you know, a foot in your ass, right, you come back and say, okay, well, maybe y'all can keep the land and just, right, you know, right, give us right, a little bit of the land. Yeah. And then right, they move in, you know, the settlers move in farther than Palestine. Right. And I say, well, okay, you know what? Just don't come any farther than this. So you sold out to the original principle. You become compromising. So that is like selling out. That is selling out to the cause. You know what I'm saying? Now, if your cause, if you're a reformist, like you may have, they may have some politicians over there that are some people. The thing is, what do the masses of people want? I think that that's what the right, major
exactly, question
is.
Right. You're what a traitor masses, to your people.
Right. What do the masses want? You know, we have the same problem in our struggle. They give us these leaders, these Jesses and these Al Sharptons, and they come on here and brothers are like, man, nobody want that. We tired of police killing us in Ferguson and right, this and that. Don't keep coming. We don't want ham sandwiches.
Right. Because really, the agenda, I'm just going to keep it real,
yeah,
of the black community, it, no offense, Vince, is to legalize weed for the black males to pull up their pants,
yeah,
and to stop selling drugs.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I'm like, well, I didn't partake in this.
Yeah.
So I'm saying if the majority of black people go against the cause, doesn't that make them all traitors?
No.
That,
no,
even if it's no,
it makes, it makes, if the majority of black people go against the cause, then we have to look at, that's not the cause of the majority. If the majority right, is saying we don't want this, and you got a minority few saying, well, this is what we want, and then you have a leader speaking for that, they've sold the cause out. Because they're no longer speaking for the masses.
Okay.
The masses run. If the mass of Palestinians are saying we want to end to Zionism, we want the illegal occupation of our land and calling it Israel or whatever they're calling it, we want to stop to that. If the masses of people saying that and the leaders don't reflect that, then the leaders have sold the masses out.
Right. Right.
But if you have right, if you have a minority speaking and saying, well, this is our cause, and the masses are saying, no, that's not our cause, and they say, yes, it is, and since we got the cameras and since we got this, right, no, they've sold out.
Yeah.
It's the masses yeah, always speak.
Right. Yeah, and I completely agree yeah, with you, but like for example, like you were saying, the black community in the United States, is it their top priority to end police brutality, or right, is it to legalize marijuana? You know what I mean? So
yeah,
it's like right, you have your own people selling themselves out, so...
We don't well, have.
You see,
it's hard for us
so
to
what if tomorrow? So what if tomorrow?
Agenda.
Tomorrow, so they take. There is a survey, and it says the majority of black people, 75% of black people, don't believe black people are oppressed in America. Okay, are
right,
they traitors? Even though they're the majority.
Well, let me answer that question.
Yeah.
You know
yeah,
let me answer that question.
Yeah.
A majority of. Those black people will probably be end up raised in the suburbs.
Okay.
Going to a private school.
Yes.
Got white friends. They're going to college with a scholarship.
Hey,
so
I got white friends.
Right. So no.
but it affects a lot
how
of people's
how can I convince
mindset,
these people?
Yeah.
Right. How can I convince these people that they're oppressed and he's goddamn living better than I am?
So
he's
you wouldn't call him a traitor?
No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't. No, I wouldn't call him a traitor because I think the revolution.
So what if you're out there protesting for a black cause and this black guy walks up to you and he's like, "Stop! I'm living fine. My family's
and we have
working
that
fine."
Right.
Okay,
right.
So you wouldn't call him a traitor?
No, I think that steps have to be.
I wouldn't call him a traitor.
Let me jump in. Steps have to be taken.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Steps have to. If I'm out there protesting for a cause and I don't have the masses behind me, I've went to step two before taking step one, which is educating the masses.
Okay.
You have to first educate
yeah,
the masses to the ills that are going on. You have
okay,
to say, you know, he's ignorant at
yes,
this point. I'm not
right,
going to call him
right,
a traitor.
Right, right,
he's
right,
ignorant. I have to point out, hey, man, you think you have it. This is our history.
Right.
This is what's happening. This is what, until we get it down to at least... You know, what 49% say that you like, we got to take it to the next call.
I'm living in Beverly Hills.
Yeah.
I play for the 49ers.
Right.
I got buku cars.
Right.
How are you going to convince me?
I'm going to tell you why. It's not about convincing you. It's about convincing the numbers.
Right.
75% don't live in Beverly Hills.
Right.
75% don't have that. I don't care if 10%, 20% married to a white woman living in Beverly, living the life. If I got the masses.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? You're not going to always get 100% of the people. You're not always going to. But
no,
when the masses all agree, when
let
you got
see,
the majority of the people saying, hey, we all oppressed, we're living in conditions that have to change, because that's what the whole thing is about. It's about changing the conditions that affect the masses of the people,
right,
not the Mahmoud Abbas's, the 2%, the 3% that are living good off the oppression and exploitation
right,
of the masses of the people. And that's, you know, according to Mariam, that's exactly what he's doing. So an education process has to take place to the people, not every, because what our problem is, why 75% of the people say that, and be brief, say that we're not oppressed is because they're living the dream.
You're right.
So you have to, they're not living the dream, they're aspiring for a dream.
Right, right.
But when you introduce them to the reality of what they're living, man, you get out of BET, turn the TV off.
Right.
Okay.
Close the radio down. Right. Now look around. Damn, I'm broken, I'm hungry. They shooting outside, they gangbanging, right. They selling dope. That's your reality.
Okay, so now at that point, do you offer them a solution?
That's when the solution
and
comes.
And what
in.
I'm saying is, I am 41 years old, and these groups have not offered any type of solution but some pie in the sky.
Now that right there, I would agree. That right there, after the Black Panther Party third development, what some people call original,
right.
The 10-point platform and the programs
that's
excluding
the Black Nationals.
Right, excluding that. I would totally agree with you. That is one of our problems. That's why you said, you know, they having sneaker giveaways. Vote for me and I give you a pair of Jordans.
Right.
That's why they saying, you know,
right.
Vote for me and I legalize
Dougie last week,
marijuana.
What is the agenda? He
right.
started
well, because we don't
the
have
Republicans are racist.
The black man
like
in, right. The black man here in America, the African here in America, doesn't have a clear-cut agenda because of, like you said, they destroy our mass education progress. The Malcolms, right. The Marcus Garveys, the Elijah Muhammads, the whatever our leaders that come out. Me. You, I'm scared to walk out of the studio now for some of these sessions we be having. I don't know if they're snatching a black van and y'all never see me again. You know what I'm saying? So when you go into a mass educational process, you get targeted. But it's about educating the masses so they can look around and see that the condition's not right and they want to change their own conditions. Like Maddie was saying, the children who, they don't have to sit around and have classes on teaching you're oppressed. Little Palestine, but they look out the window and see a damn tank. They've been living,
exactly.
They live in refugee
right.
camps, for God's sake.
Which is what right. makes those who do join the military traitors.
Right,
right.
Because it is, well, it's not in front of them because they're living in settler colony of Israel. They know exactly.
But Mary,
they're
no.
enforcing the occupation.
Yes,
yes.
Okay,
they're enforcing
listen.
The occupation.
Yes. Listen, you go to a child that's been in the refugee camps. Now you got this whole savior Israeli saying, you know, join our army. And
well,
you
no, they don't
condition.
Go to the refugee camps. They know better. That won't happen.
Oh, okay,
they
gotcha.
Don't go
okay.
into the West Bank and Gaza and recruit. No, no. They go into these Palestinians living
into
in Israel. What they
territory.
Do, they go to them as collaborators. They'll say, you're like I was telling you, Vincent, your neighbor,
oh,
okay. your neighbor
oh,
is...
Oh, the bourgeoisies.
They
should have said that.
They're privileged.
Yeah. They're privileged yeah. Palestinians.
Right, they're privileged. They're going to try to maintain
yeah.
the status
Look,
quo.
I mean, no, because this is... There's a lot to this. What I'm saying right now is a completely different concept. Okay. It's okay for the next show.
We got right. We got like 6 minutes.
Yeah.
I got a quick quote I want to read, and I want to
okay.
get y'all responses to it. This is a quote from Benjamin Netanyahu in response to what President Abbas said. Netanyahu, in a televised address, accused Abbas of inciting the recent violence and said his condemnation of the attack was insufficient. This is the kicker. Netanyahu earlier stated the international community irresponsibly ignores Arab attacks on Jews around the world.
Yeah.
Can I get some
I'm gonna respond
on
last.
That, please?
Starting with me? Let's start with
yeah,
it.
Yeah, you go
starting
first.
With me in response. I mean, it's classic, and I'm not knocking.
I thought
classic.
That was hilarious
it's,
when
it's
I read
classic.
That.
And I'm not knocking, you know what I'm saying, our Jewish people. Yeah, I am. Right. this particular, I mean, it's classic. They have one of the weapons for Jewish people have been that anti-Semitism
mm-hmm. yes.
right.
from
yes.
day
right.
one. You know what I'm saying? I mean, if you say Jew the wrong way, if you don't
right.
pronounce it with an accent, you know what I'm
I
saying?
Thought
I mean,
about
you
that earlier saying Jew the wrong way.
Right, you can't, right. You be scared to say Jew on the show. You know what I'm saying? And it's a classic thing, and then they go start showing you tattoos or Auschwitz and
right,
all
right,
kinds
right,
of
right,
like
right.
that. You know, I mean, they play on the sympathy.
Right.
They have always been a woe is me people, and that is one of the biggest weapons that they use. Now, you let you and I say that, they say, oh, get over it. Slavery's been over.
Right.
Yeah.
You're right.
Right.
Miriam?
Yeah, well, I wanted to say that. It's just a lot of trying to brainwash whoever listened to
more
that.
More propaganda.
Quote. Yeah, more
yeah.
propaganda. I mean, I'm surprised he didn't, like you said, throw in the Holocaust
yeah.
in there. Like, you know what I mean? Right. Like, that's what they do. Holocaust over and over and over again. Persecution in Europe over and over again. It's not happening now.
Yeah.
What
yeah.
matters now is the
so
persecution
now,
of
now
the
they're doing
yeah,
it to
they're,
other
they're
people.
Different.
Right, they're doing
yeah.
it to other people.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let me give you my Benjamin Netanyahu imitation. See, the people of Palestine are terrorists. And we offer them positions in our military.
Right.
We're very peaceful people. They attack us. They're terrorists. So with that being said, that's not what I'm saying. I think, you know, he's basically got America backing him.
Yeah.
He's got weapons. He's
America
gangster,
and
you know?
UK.
Right.
I mean.
So they're going to use double language, you know, just like, you know,
right.
Our government used double language.
I mean, and they lose on the social media platform. Like, I think I've said this before, you know, kids, the youth aren't turning on CNN. They're not turning on Fox. They're not going to waste their time. Yeah. You know, they're going to go to social media, Twitter, Facebook, whatever, and it's all pro-Palestine.
But, Mariam, we are not looking for the approval of the mass media.
And the problem with that, though, is, and that's why it has to translate into real political economic power. Mm-hmm. Because they don't care what you're saying on Facebook and on Twitter.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? They're going to the CNN and the Fox News, and the people that watch those are the people who spend and the people
who make
vote.
Decisions.
Right.
Yes.
And make governmental policies. So I would advocate for our people watching these on the social media, if you're old enough to vote, if you're old enough to implement, watch your spending. Don't back people who back, don't spend your dollars with companies that back Israel and the atrocities that they're participating in. Save your dollar from that economic boycott, political boycott. Write your congressman, write everybody, let them know that you're not happy with the United States supporting these atrocities. You have to get involved. It's not good enough to click like.
Right, that's right. Mary, you got to come back on.
Man, we got to.
Yeah, for sure.
This is going to go deep. I mean, we just scratched the surface.
Yeah. You know, President Obama condemned the synagogue attacks too.
Oh, absolutely. He has to.
Sure. Yeah. I mean,
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and I just want to include that. You can.
No.
No, say what you were gonna say.
Oh, y'all can get off the brother.
Oh no, he said
y'all get off the brother.
Hold up, there is and can be no justification for such attacks against innocent civilians. The thoughts and prayers of the American people are with the victims and families of all those who were killed and injured in this horrific attack and other recent violence. Then he called on Israel, Palestinian leaders, and even the ordinary citizens to come together and reject violence and find an effort
now,
towards peace.
I am going to say that, Mariam. I am going to say that, and this is not to knock their martyrdom, but I am going to say that Islam teaches us that we do fight the combatants. There is no excuse for...
But they're not civilians. They're colonists. That's the difference. That there's no such thing as an Israeli civilian.
Wait. I see what Yang is saying. It's the corporations that are doing that, and then they tell the citizens you can move in there. So it's like...
No, they made...
It's like he's selling you a stolen car.
No. They made the decision to leave the United States and immigrate to the settler colony of Israel, which means that they made the decision that if they are going to get killed, they can be killed by the indigenous of Palestine.
They're not civilians.
Did the Native Americans have the right to kill the British?
Do the Native Americans have the right to kill the British?
From my principles of war, we gotta wrap it up. And I will give that answer when we come back.
We'll continue this debate at another time.
Yeah.
We out, peace.
Peace, Canathon. Check
Saved
us out.
By the time.
December 5th, yes. Canathon.
Now I'm gonna look up these Eagle Scouts. Who the hell are these Eagle Scouts?
The Fraternal Order of Eagles. They're
a
very old humanitarian group established in 1800.